Your Honor, before I begin, if I can just explain that I'm splitting time with my co-counsel. I'm Justin Smith. I represent the Arizona Senate President Warren Peterson and Arizona Speaker of the House Ben Thoma. My co-counsel Maria Sims represents the State Superintendent Thomas Horn. She'll be addressing the equitable factors for 5 minutes. I'll be speaking for 10 minutes.
Fine. Whatever you want to do is fine.
Yes.
Thank you. Welcome to the Ninth Circuit. Just keep an eye on the clock, and we're ready for your argument.
Yes. Thank you. And may I reserve time for rebuttal?
You bet.
May it please the court. Your Honor, this case differs from this court's decision in the Hecox case in three material ways. The first is on the standard of review. The district court erred as a matter of law because it should have applied rational basis review to this under-inclusiveness challenge. And to the extent that this court believes that intermediate scrutiny applies, the district court also erred because it required a perfect fit between the Arizona law and every citizen in Arizona. The second material difference is at the legislative record. The district court clearly erred because it ignored or dismissed overwhelming evidence before the legislature showing that biological males have a distinct performance advantage over biological females in athletics, including before puberty. And third, unlike in Hecox, the district court reached Title IX and erred by finding that the Arizona law violated Title IX based on Title IX's plain meaning, history, and relevant precedent. Let's start with the very first material difference with Hecox, and that's the standard of review. The first step in equal protection cases, as the court knows, is to determine the classification of the law. And here the classification is based on sex between boys and girls in athletics. Plaintiffs do not challenge that classification. In fact, they agree that schools can and should separate sports teams on the basis of sex.
That's been law for many decades. So you know the response to this, of course, is there was a status quo, and then there was legislation, and the legislation seemed to target and single out transgender women. So what is your response to that, please? Why shouldn't we review this as a transgender ban?
Yeah, of course. The status quo before the legislature was a single sports association. Arizona has multiple statewide associations that had rules only for high school. That association did not regulate middle school, and it had a confidential black box process for determining when students could cross over. And Arizona had a history, unlike in Idaho, of biological males trying to participate in female sports. These are the Clark cases from the 1980s. Arizona also, unlike Idaho, also had evidence that at least 7 students had played on sports teams that did not match their birth sex. In Idaho, Hecox was thought to be the very first athlete in that situation. So there's lack of anecdotal evidence in Idaho that Arizona had. And so this law did affect a change in the status quo because it provided a clear, consistent standard where it did not exist in middle school. It was inconsistent and confidential in high school. And the day before the Arizona in a Senate hearing, the NCAA had outsourced its rules for national and international governing bodies based on the sport. And so with that patchwork of rules across all ages, the Arizona legislature was justified in putting forth a single objective standard that was not meant to target, but as the legislative findings show, was based on extensive scientific evidence showing a physiological difference.
Can we go to your extensive... Oh, yeah. Go right ahead.
On that extensive scientific evidence, it seems to me it depends, you know, we're looking here at prepubescent boys and girls and transgender girls who took these blockers before age 11. And a lot of the evidence really relates to after that. So it's hard for me to say, well, there's absolutely clear scientific evidence. With what we really do have in the record, if the standard is intermediate scrutiny, how can the state meet that?
Yeah, Your Honor, a couple of responses to that. The first is this court in Second Amendment cases, which apply a higher level of scrutiny, has found that when there's conflicting evidence in the legislative record, they defer to the legislature to amass and review those cases. I'd point the court to the Pena v. Lindley case that Judge McEwen, you wrote a few years ago. That showed that the legislature is best positioned to make those judgment calls. But as to the evidence specifically before the legislature, if you look at legislative findings number 6 and number 9, there were findings and studies cited that went down to kids as low as 6 years old.
Is there any finding? I've looked at these, and I want to make sure you haven't missed one. I didn't see one that addressed prepubescent athletes where there wasn't at least some partial puberty blockers, as opposed to the plaintiffs in this case who had block puberty.
Sure. So in legislative finding number 9, there's a study cited by Dr. Hilton that has two different cohorts of students. There are 85,000 children in Australia from ages 9 up to 17, and then 424,000 students in Greece down from age 6 up
and
to 18.
And those are partial puberty blockers, right, in those studies?
Yeah, so kids at ages 6 up to, you know, let's just say 11, would not have any puberty blockers at issue. So they include pre-puberty kids in those studies. It's true, it also includes post-puberty, but the findings were consistent across ages, that boys were faster and stronger and had athletic advantages. And those studies were considered by the legislature. And if you also look at the legislative transcripts, the plaintiffs admitted the Senate transcript into the record below, there was no conflicting scientific evidence showing that there was not a competitive advantage for biological boys over girls at any level.
So your position is that we should disregard the district court's findings of fact?
Our position is that the district court clearly erred by finding that there was no difference among pre-puberty boys.
Because?
It clearly erred because there was evidence in the record, those two studies I just mentioned. We also had the four expert reports showing, including Arizona-specific track data in middle school, that there was a difference. And the district court recognized that there were small or minimal differences and then still reached, we believe, an incorrect conclusion under intermediate scrutiny. This infected its substantial relationship analysis.
She said that the district court found that there were, to the extent there were differences, there were small differences that weren't attributed to innate biological differences. Why was she wrong about that?
We believe that finding was based on speculation about atmospherics, why boys might be, you know, have different advantages over girls that were unrelated to physiological differences. But even if that were true,
didn't she have evidence in the record to that effect? We can't retry the facts here, but we've got, you know, the standard for our deference to the findings of fact from the district court. So.
Of course, and the district court did have an expert report from an endocrinologist the plaintiffs put in that did testify to those things. But we think even if you accept that it's true that there are non-physiological reasons for boys having an advantage over girls, that the legislature would still be justified in creating this difference between sports teams. And when we look at the Hecox analysis under intermediate scrutiny, if the court chooses to apply that in this case, the court looked when it recognized and acknowledged that there was an important governmental interest in the Idaho law, and that same interest would exist here. It was a substantial relationship that the Hecox court faulted in Idaho's law, and it based it on three different things: the scientific evidence, the anecdotal evidence, and then the kind of the atmospherics of the law's passage. And you know, we've been discussing the scientific evidence here. We believe that shows overwhelming support for separation. And then on the anecdotal evidence, again, there was evidence in Arizona of a historic problem, and that was currently ongoing.
And what is the historic
problem?
Well, again, going back to the 1980s, that there had been boys trying to play in girls' sports, and that was evidence.
Why was it a problem? They had a status quo that accounted for this, right?
The status quo, again, we think the status quo was inconsistent with preventing biological males from playing with biological females for the reasons I just mentioned, you know, not having a role
in the middle. But did Arizona allow transgender females to play in male sports?
They did, Your Honor. Just like they would biological girls who identify as girls to play over in male sports. I understood what you meant, Judge Ezra. But for those reasons, we think that this case differs from the Hecox. And, you know, Hecox went out of his way to repeatedly say that it was narrow, it was extraordinarily fact-bound, that it was just based on the record before the district court. And we think that the evidence in the record below is much stronger in this case than it was in the Idaho case.
Do you have any examples of Arizona athletes that have complained about unfairness, about competing against a transgender girl?
Yeah, so there was a mom who testified to the Arizona Senate. She also co-signed an amicus brief filed by the Arizona Women of Action. Her name's Amber Zinzak.
Any athletes or just the mom?
Well, she said her daughter was playing in school basketball, and that there was a biological boy on the other team who was dominating, discouraged the girls on both teams. She presented that as a second witness to the Arizona Senate, and then she repeated her story in the amicus brief to this court. So the Senate did have evidence before it of girls being displaced by non-biological girls. If I can just quickly turn to the Title IX issue, we contend that the court erred as a matter of law on this because the definition of sex, when Title IX was passed, meant biological sex. We think the 11th Circuit's decision in Adams does a good job of looking at the different dictionaries that were in existence at the time and concluding that sex did mean biological. The Title IX regulations only make sense if it does mean biological, because you're looking at sports and living facilities and same-sex institutions. There are references to both sexes or the other sex. So we think, based on the plain text, both of the word itself as well as context and the surrounding parts of the statute and regulations, that sex only means biological sex.
Counsel, did you want to reserve some time?
I did want to reserve time.
We've got 4 minutes on the clock for you, a little more than that.
If there are no further questions, I'll save that for rebuttal.
Okay. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the Court, Maria Sims on behalf of Arizona Superintendent of Public Instruction Tom Horn, and I will be talking about why the equitable factors support the law and why girls are being harmed by the preliminary injunction. Allowing the district court's ruling to stand sends a message to a generation of young girls that no matter how talented they are or how hard they work, it simply doesn't matter. Because of undisputed biological realities that my colleague just spoke about.
Counsel, how can you say they're undisputed biological realities? You're losing me right there. Can you back up and help me with that assertion?
Yes, Your Honor. We presented an ocean of expert testimony about the scientific reality pre-puberty that shows that there are competitive advantages that cannot be suppressed by puberty blockers. And if I might add,
what about the findings the district court made? When you say there was an ocean of evidence, help me out with the findings, and you know the standards, so I don't want to waste your time.
Yes.
The deference we must owe to those findings. So could you please address that?
Yes, Your Honor. And you have the exact same findings. I'll just point out to the court that the evidence was all written testimony that you have available to you to review just as well. And yes, the court did make those findings, but we believe, as my colleague suggested, that the court erred in dismissing out of hand and not considering the overwhelming scientific evidence, peer-reviewed articles that show that those advantages cannot be suppressed sufficiently. When you're talking about,
if you go to the language of the court, it says the data relied on by Horn merely observes phenomena across a population sample in isolated areas and does not determine a cause for what is observed. What's wrong with that finding?
Well, I think that you're talking about perhaps the atmospheric circumstances that the court relied on that was mentioned earlier.
And I think the court is taking a look at all of the evidence that was offered, and we've got, and basically saying, yeah, we've got this from here and that from there, and we have isolated examples and isolated areas, but that doesn't establish a baseline, is what the court is saying, and I don't know why that is clearly erroneous.
Well, we would disagree with the court that it is isolated incidents, as we have four experts with extensive studies. My colleague mentioned the studies, the pre-puberty studies without puberty blockers of the children having boys having competitive advantages. Expansive studies in Australia, in Greece, that show that those advantages cannot be suppressed by what I would call experimental puberty blockers. And in fact, just this week, England's National Health Service banned puberty blockers for children 18 and under.
The counsel, you can't go outside the record, and we can't either.
Well, but this is in the public realm.
We Are you asking us to take judicial notice?
Yes, we would love the court
file
to take
a motion
judicial
for that.
We can supplement. We'd be happy to.
We really need to follow the rules.
I understand. I'm trying to, Your Honor. But I think that that points out that it supports what our experts have already said in the record and why we believe that the court
clearly erred in dismissing those important studies that show these puberty blockers are experimental, they're not safe, and they're unreliable. And we even put in...
I think you have a point that the science in this area is I will say, evolving, or it's not done yet, for lack of a better term. So you have to sort of transplant that onto the realm that we're in and the rules that we have to abide by. So Judge McEwen has asked you questions, I guess I have as well, about the standard. We have to look at the record that we've got, which is fixed, and you're predicting some after some events that have occurred later. So we're at the preliminary injunction stage. So we're going to be strict about looking at what the district court had before it. And we need to figure out why, whether there's merit to your contention that her findings of fact were clearly erroneous.
Your point is well taken, Your Honor, and I don't think that the court needs to become a scientific expert in order to decide this case at the preliminary injunction stage and on appeal, because we
have also put in expert testimony from a coach that is undisputed, and we believe that a coach who's on the field as a practical matter, who's seeing these competitive advantages on a daily basis.
Telling me, forgive me for interrupting, but time is short, and you're telling me why the district court should have been persuaded by that evidence.
Yes.
Right, so what you have to convince me is that she had a mix of evidence and that her findings were clearly erroneous. What's your best shot at that, please?
Well, I would say that if I would invite the court to look at Coach Blade and see that, as a practical matter, we have a coach who's out there on the field seeing these competitive advantages topple girls off the winner's podium every day. And we know that the preliminary injunction in this case and in other cases where preliminary injunctions have been issued are already accomplishing that goal, where girls are losing.
I mean, you want me to look at ER? What? Where in the record? Coach Blade is going to say that girls are toppled every day. What is it?
I'm sorry. It's Coach Blade's expert testimony. I'd have to look at my notes for the exact.
That's fine. I can find the testimony. I think I've read the testimony. But your contention is that it supports the proposition that what is toppled every day? Could you?
I'm sorry.
I missed part of that in the echo in this room.
That's all right. That girls are losing. They are competing. Basically, the preliminary injunction is having girls compete for second place, which can mean the difference between winning and losing, victory and defeat, college scholarships, and not going to college at all, which are significant. Now, the plaintiffs in this case want to say that these differences are minimal. And I think the court mentioned that earlier when talking to my colleague. But when you're talking about seconds and inches in the context of competitive sports, those differences are significant and meaningful.
We appreciate your argument. You're now significantly over your time.
Sorry,
that clock is going back up now.
Sorry, Your Honor.
That's all right. You don't owe me an apology, but it's my job to try to keep the trains running on time here. So I'm going to stop you there.
There are no further questions. Thank you, Your Honor. I appreciate the court's attention.
Not at all. We'll hear from opposing counsel, please. If you could keep an eye on the time, I'd appreciate it.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court, Justin Rassi of Debevoise and Plimpton, appearing for plaintiffs' appellees, and joining me at the bar table are Ms. Berg and Ms. Zimmerman. I want to start with the question that Judge McEwen posed: was there a problem in Arizona prior to the enactment of this legislation? And the answer to that is no. In fact, Senator Warren Peterson, represented by Mr. Smith, testified on the legislative record that he was not aware of a specific instance where any girl in Arizona had lost a place on the team prior to the enactment of that legislation. That's in the excerpts of record at page 16.
Well, losing a place on the team is not winning. I mean, I think that your opposing counsel's argument is that cisgender athletes have a disadvantage against transgender athletes, even if it's de minimis. De minimis counts. That was her argument. So I don't think it was losing a place on the team. It was winning or having an opportunity to win.
Judge Ezra, if a girl, we would say that if a girl...
I'm not saying I agree with her, but I'm just saying that's her argument.
I understand the argument, but if there was no example of a single girl ever displacing another girl from a team, it follows that there is also no issue of a transgender girl ever depriving another girl of winning on that team.
They take the position, I think it was in the opening brief, that even one transgender girl who might displace a cisgender girl would result in discrimination. Do you agree with that position as in terms of the framework for looking at this case?
No, I don't agree with that position. And perhaps I can come back to the steps in the analysis that we say this short court should follow. The first step is that heightened scrutiny should apply. We do not accept the proposition that this is an under-inclusiveness challenge that somehow subverts this court's decision in Hecox. The Ninth Circuit has been clear across multiple cases, Karnofsky, Hecox, Doe v. Snyder, that where a statute discriminates against a transgender person, it triggers heightened scrutiny. That is a settled question. This law clearly discriminates against transgender women and girls, as the district court correctly found. This law applies to every single transgender woman and girl in Arizona. It takes this concept of biological sex, it fixes that concept at birth or possibly even in utero, and it says if you are male under that concept, then you cannot play on a girl's sports teams.
Opposing counsel makes an argument here that didn't appear in Hecox, and that is the argument, that, as you know, that this is a remedial statute and under-inclusive. What is your response to that, please?
There is nothing remedial whatsoever about this statute. This statute does not do anything that did not already exist in the state of Arizona. There have been separate teams for boys and girls in Arizona since this court's decision in Clark in 1982, 40 years ago. There's been equal funding for girls and women's sports teams in Arizona since Title IX was passed in 1972. All that this statute does is abrogate the existing position in Arizona where transgender girls could play on girls' sports teams. It is clear both from the, it is clear on the face of the statute that it is designed to target and discriminate against transgender women and exclude them from girls' sports teams. And in each of the six cases that appellants rely upon for this under-inclusiveness theory, they are so inapposite. If we look at Jana Rock, it's a case about affording certification to minority businesses so they can access government contracts. Huhuli and Ariyoshi is about affording and distributing land and income to the indigenous people of Hawaii. Shulban Kwebel is about a bail reform statute that was designed to reform bail bondsman position in Illinois, which the Supreme Court described as being in full and odorous bloom. Each of these examples are remedial statutes or social welfare schemes or affirmative action programs where the legislation was distributing some sort of benefit or remediating some sort of discrimination. That is not this statute, because the statute did nothing to change the existing position in the state of Arizona.
You know, go ahead, Judge.
Okay, thank you. Opposing counsel argues, sir, that even if you're right and intermediate scrutiny applies, that this was imperfectly tailored. Can you speak to that?
No, the district judge did precisely what this court instructed in Hecox and applied intermediate scrutiny to the ban before her. The district judge was expressly clear in paragraph, I think it's 157 of her analysis, which says that the legislature does not need to choose the wisest alternative under intermediate scrutiny. I just want to make sure that I have the right reference for that, because 157...
That's correct.
I think it is.
150, it was 150. Yes. And what the district judge there was saying, that looking at this legislation, its text, its effect, its consequence, its structure, and in considering the record before it, this legislation was overbroad. It applies to every single transgender girl and women in Arizona, as young as kindergarten, in every single level of sports competition, in every sport, without any regard whatsoever to an individual's circumstances. And it relies upon the erroneous assumption that transgender status is a proxy for athletic ability, which it is not, which this court rejected in Hecox. And the district judge, therefore, did not rely, did not require strict scrutiny, did not require perfect tailoring. The district judge said, considering this statute before me and the record that I have, there, it is so overbroad and the state has not discharged its burden of proving that it was substantially related to legitimate governmental objectives.
But you've heard their argument, and it really consists in looking at the studies cited by the legislature and a large number of studies. And we, of course, give certain deference to the legislative, I don't know if they're findings per se, but, you know, they definitely are the various studies. But we also have the district court finding and even acknowledging some absence of evidence in terms of making a firm decision. How does that play in these two competing findings in a preliminary injunction proceeding?
The district judge is required to take into account the legislative findings, which were in the record, and the expert evidence, which is in the record. And
what's their strongest study?
I'm sorry?
What's opposing counsel's strongest study?
I don't think that any of their studies are strong, Judge Kristen, because none of their studies go to the specific question of whether or not prepubertal boys and girls have physiological differences between them. And I heard Mr. Smith say this morning that, in fact, there is evidence from plaintiffs, the evidence of Dr. Schumer. Dr. Schumer is a pediatric endocrinologist. He has extensive experience. He's treated over 600 transgender children. And his evidence was twofold. First, that there are no significant differences in athletic performance prior to puberty. And that is because the scientific consensus, the weight of the medical evidence is that physiological differences emerge as a result of exposure to circulating testosterone that occurs during male puberty. As a result, children that have not gone through male puberty, or persons that will never go through male puberty because they've either taken puberty blockers or are taking cross-sex hormones, hormone replacement therapy, will never have those physiological advantages that inure during male puberty.
One way this case differs is that the plaintiff in Hecox, of course, had experienced puberty and was taking hormone therapies to suppress circulating testosterone levels. But I think the record in this case is that both of these plaintiffs had not experienced puberty and will not. Is that correct?
So both of my clients are now taking puberty blockers. Megan, who was 16, was already taking puberty blockers from the time this statute was enacted. Jane started taking them.
But setting aside the statute, I'm trying to make sure these two plaintiffs did not experience puberty. Because
they did not, and they will not experience.
The record explains this, I think.
It does.
All right.
It's in the declarations of both the parents, the mothers of both children, which testify to the fact that they are taking puberty blockers and cross-sex hormones.
Right. Another way that this case differs from Hecox is the scope of this injunction. Would you speak to that? Because I want to make sure that opposing counsel gets a chance to respond to this as well.
We brought this case as an as-applied challenge, and the district judge correctly tailored this injunction to these two plaintiffs only. The district judge's findings make clear that it's a prohibitory injunction. It only prevents the enforcement of this statute as against Jane and Megan. This case was not conducted as a facial challenge, and that is because the Supreme Court and Ninth Circuit has said that as-applied challenges are a favorable prudential vehicle for constitutional determinations. The district judge in no way decided this on a facial basis, and the injunction here does not apply more broadly as the issue came up in Hecox. As I understand the concern in Hecox, there was a question there around whether or not the injunction applied to every transgender woman and girl in the state of Idaho, whereas here it is clear it only applies to these two plaintiffs, and appellants have not argued otherwise.
I think Judge Ezra had a question and I interrupted.
No, that was fine. It seems to me, what sports, remind me now, that do Jane and Megan propose to engage in?
Megan is volleyball, and Jane is soccer, cross country, and basketball.
So these are pure team sports?
Correct.
Okay. It seems
Judge Ezra, I don't mean to interrupt. Cross country.
Cross country is not, obviously. Cross country is more of an individual sport, but you can have teams.
Yes.
In virtually every. But it seems to me that it's of greater concern in individual competitive sports or sports where people play as individuals. You might aggregate their results ultimately, but for instance, shot put, track, running, those kinds of sports versus, say, basketball, where you might get a transgender female who happens to be 6'8" or 6'9" playing on a basketball team. I mean, having somebody that's tall like that is not necessarily going to give one team over another a huge competitive advantage, but you have very tall people anyway. Believe me, San Antonio Spurs have Wembanyama and it hasn't gone well.
All I would say to that is that simply knowing that a person is transgender tells you nothing about their athletic ability. A person can be a transgender girl. They might be woeful at sports, as I am. They might be wonderful at sports, as the San Antonio Spurs wish to be. But all I wish to say is that this law rests on the erroneous assumption that transgender status is a proxy for athletic ability, and it is simply not. I'd also just like to obviously briefly address, to the extent there was any question around this latest evidence from England on puberty blockers. It's not part of the record. This court should not take judicial notice of that. Medical treatment for transgender individuals is not an issue in this case, and we would ask the court not to take judicial notice of that.
Would you have opposition to their filing a motion to have it be taken into consideration, giving you an opportunity to respond?
If the court wishes to hear the issue that way, we have no opposition to it. We would say it is totally irrelevant because the...
Are you talking about... I'm not sure. I want to make sure we understand this. I invited opposing counsel after saying that we're not going to consider anything outside of the record. If she wanted to file a motion for judicial notice, she could do that. So are you now saying you wouldn't oppose that motion, or you wouldn't oppose us considering that motion, or what is it you're telling us?
I don't think that motion is necessary, but we are prepared to oppose it if the court wishes to grant that right.
I guess we should see what it is first, right?
Make sure I clarify what it is you were saying you didn't oppose.
But fundamentally, it seems to be appellant's case this morning that they wish to relitigate factual issues that the district judge fully and fairly considered.
Well, I think that we push back on that pretty hard, but I need to push back on you. We do owe deference. We have this mixed bag of findings. I don't know if findings is the right word, but we have this legislative record as well as the district court's findings, and opposing counsel has argued that the district court clearly erred because she disregarded, I think that's the right verb, I think that's the verb that was used by opposing counsel, disregarded part of the record. Do you want to respond to that?
Clear error is not shown by simply pointing to conflicting pieces of evidence in the record.
She says yes, that's correct, and I think opposing counsel would agree with that. That wasn't her position. Her position was that the district court disregarded some evidence.
The district court did not disregard any evidence. In fact, the district judge took a forensic approach to this evidence. The factual findings indicate that. The factual findings, particularly at paragraph 157 and 158, show in detail all of the failings on the state's part when it came to their evidentiary burden. It said that the state had failed to prove that prior to puberty there were physiological differences between boys and girls. The state had failed to prove that there was any issue of competitive fairness or safety that had been presented by transgender girls in the state of Arizona. The district judge took into account each of the expert reports submitted by both sides, weighed that evidence, and came to factual findings that were open to the district judge on the record. It is not error, much less clear error, that the district judge credited the findings of Dr. Schumer, a pediatric endocrinologist with extensive experience.
If we think that are left with the impression from this record, the finite record that we have, that the science in this area is evolving, which way does that cut?
It would still cut in plaintiff's favor because the district judge recognized, I think, that further factual issues will need to be fleshed out in as this case proceeds on the merits, that each party will have the opportunity to take discovery, conduct depositions of the experts, present their case at trial. The district judge was correct on the record before her that what she had in reviewing the statute against that record, that it failed intermediate scrutiny, and this court should affirm that. The district judge did precisely what she was supposed to do on a preliminary injunction record. And I just want to be clear about the two studies that were referenced by both Mr. Smith and Ms. Sims coming out of Australia and Greece. And I just want to be crystal clear. Neither of those studies controlled for persons that were transgender, and neither of those studies controlled for persons that were taking puberty blockers. They are simply observational studies across many children of many different circumstances, and that's really what Dr. Schumer was driving at. He says that to the extent you can show some differences, however minimal, in some discrete activities between boys and girls, the evidence adduced does not show its cause. It does not explain its cause. It could be...
Are you talking about boys and girls pre-puberty?
Boys and girls pre-puberty, yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It could be that boys are more encouraged to play sports and therefore have more opportunities. It could be because of social factors. We simply do not know, and the state failed to discharge its burden on that point. And fatally...
Let me just make sure that I'm understanding. You think the state failed to discharge its burden because it didn't show that any differences are attributable to inherent biological advantages?
It failed to justify this law by showing that it was substantially related to legitimate governmental objectives, and it failed to show that there is a need or that it is substantially related to fairness in women's sports or to safety to ban every single transgender girl in every single sport at every age level, in every level of competition, without regard to their individual circumstances. That is what the state failed to do, and that is why the law does not survive heightened scrutiny. And just in my remaining time, I wanted to briefly address both Title IX.
Oh, good, because I was about to ask you about Title IX. So go ahead.
If you have a question, I'm happy.
Well, I mean, the question I have is really whether there is a claim there under Title IX. We've had, of course, ins and outs of things being withdrawn,
You're only referencing Department of Education,
yes,
guidelines?
Yes, right. And so I think the question is whether the state would have really been on clear notice about the funding issue tied to this. And that relates also to, well, what does sex mean in Title IX, and is that different than Title VII? So that's a lot of questions, but they're all packaged into, do you really have a Title IX claim?
Yes, we do. In my remaining minute, I'll try and take on all of those questions. The first one is, the state was on notice because the Supreme Court had decided Bostock in 2020, 2 years prior to this statute being enacted. And it has long been the law in this circuit that Title IX is construed consistently with the protections in Title VII.
But where does Title IX unambiguously state, and I think it would have to unambiguously state, that a recipient of federal funds cannot exclude transgender females?
We disagree. The Supreme Court said in Bostock that...
Which part of that do you disagree with?
That it would need to specify...
Unambiguously?
Unambiguously. Sex includes gender identity. The Supreme Court said in Bostock that it is impossible to discriminate against a person based on their transgender status without discriminating against them on the basis of sex. And that is because gender identity is a part of sex. It is the wrong prism to view gender identity as a separate and distinct concept from sex. They are interrelated concepts. And
as used in Title IX, that's your position?
As in Title IX. I mean, the Supreme Court's decision in Bostock was Title VII, but this Court's decision in Doe v. Snyder, in Grabowski, both held that we construe in this circuit Title IX protections consistently with Title VII, and those cases and Grabowski certainly extended Bostock to the Title IX context. And
for you're over time, so let me just see if you've answered Judge McEwen's question.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think we've got your answer.
Thank you, Your Honors. For these reasons, this Court should affirm.
Thank you. We will hear rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd like to start with the questions that the court had about what happens when there's a conflict between the legislative record and the district court's record. Our position would be that the court should give deference in that case to the legislative record, and here's why. I think the Sixth Circuit decision in the Scrimeti case last September does a really good job of explaining that in our system of government that the legislatures are supposed to be these laboratories of democracy at the state level. And this court, as I mentioned on my earlier remarks, has this precedent, especially in the Second Amendment context, saying that when there is a conflict in the legislative record, the court is supposed to let the legislature make those decisions and not sit as a super legislature and second-guessing legislative
line. Judge Sutton's opinion in the Sixth Circuit case, though, they had rational basis tests. So it seems to me to be a really different problem that they were presented with.
It's a comparable statute that was arising out of Kentucky and Tennessee. It's in the same space. It did apply rational basis review. We agree with that analysis, of course. But we think that its analysis on looking to legislatures, it talks about, independent of rational basis, how states are deciding this difficult question differently, that you have some states that have certain protections on one side and different protections on the other. And
yes, but it also advocates that we should sit it out and allow this the states to work this out. As I indicated, it seems to me, I'm just one voice, that this science may still be evolving, and the Sixth Circuit advocated that the court should stay out of it. We have a controversy here presented that we have to rule on, don't we?
There is a controversy, and all I'm saying is that when there's this conflict, the court should, when it looks between the findings the district court made and the legislature, that the legislature should be given the tiebreaker in that situation.
I'm not sure it says that. I'm looking at the Supreme Court case of Gonzalez versus Carhart, and they say, although we review legislative findings under a deferential standard, the court retains an independent constitutional duty to review factual findings where constitutional rights are at stake. So the, you know, tipping the balance doesn't really appear in the Supreme Court language. I understand why there might be a preferred or a preference for that, but how do you get around this clear Supreme Court language? Really, it's back to the courts, it's saying.
Sure. And we think, as I was arguing earlier, that even if the court takes an independent view, that there would still be reason to uphold this law under an intermediate scrutiny analysis or rational basis for
that.
The
district court was required to take an independent view, wasn't she?
Yeah, the district court should have.
All right. I've understood you. I'm not trying to be difficult.
Yeah,
I wanted to make sure I understood your point.
I appreciate that, Judge Kristen. The argument that opposing counsel made was that the legislature failed to take into account individual circumstances, and this gets to our perfect fit argument, that under intermediate scrutiny, there's a long line of Supreme Court cases in Wynn and Ward versus Rock Against Racism and United States versus Edge Broadcasting, where the court's supposed to look at not how a law works in individual circumstances, but how it works to advance the governmental interest overall. And here, the overall interest is being advanced by protecting all the women in girls' sports. And the court in Wynn v. INS has a good analysis. That case involved fathers being treated differently than mothers when it came to citizenship. And the court said that the Congress could have drawn the line differently, but perhaps it chose not to because it would be subjective or intrusive or involve very difficult burdens of proof. And it upheld an objective standard because Congress had that authority. And the court said in my closing seconds that to fail to acknowledge even our most basic biological differences risks making the guarantee of equal protection superficial. And we believe that the record the legislature had before it supports a finding that the biology matters and that the legislature judgment should be upheld and the lower court reversed. Thank you all.
Thank you all for your excellent advocacy. We appreciate it very much. And we're going to take this important case under advisement. We're also going to take a 5-minute break before we hit the last argument on the record today. Thank you.